notices is that adding that pause gives us a framework in existing law and in the GDPR that is a lot better for handling big data for individuals, it's better safeguards, for regulators, because I think it gives them more tools to use to regulate, and to businesses that want to use big data responsibly, I think it gives better guidance to them. So, why is big data a legal challenge? This, to my mind, is the traditional research method. You have an idea, you have a hypothesis. Based on that hypothesis, you go and look for data to either validate or contradict your hypothesis. Big data, other way around. You get your data, you have your data, you find your data, you look in the data for hypotheses that you can then test. So, opposite order. That's a challenge because the traditional legal framework says, I have a hypothesis. I know the purpose. I know the implications. Both, or I can work them out from the hypothesis. Both if my hypothesis turns out to be true, and if my hypothesis turns out to be false, and how I need to get there. So I've got the purpose and implications before I do anything. In many fields, that's what you take to the ethics board. And if you don't satisfy the ethics board, you don't get any further. Supposing you do, that's fine, only I can see the alert. You have the ethics board, the legal people will come back with one of two choices. You can either treat it under the research exemption, which I take to be a flavour of legitimate interest. Because what you're saying there is, I've got the data already, I'm going to conduct this research in a way that minimises the risk of harm to the individual. In particular, I will give up from the start the opportunity of using this research to directly benefit those individuals. You have to say this will not support any decisions as to the individual data subject. Or, particularly if you haven't already got the data, you go out and get their consent. Please, I would like you to be a data subject. Do you agree to these purposes and implications that I've already got passed by the ethics board? Those are my two approaches. Bit of sensitive personal data, I'm very green colourblind, but I have done colour coding. This is most un-me. So why does this break for... So the controls I've got, the protections I've got. If I've gone with the blue option, the legitimate interest research, I've got a clearly stated purpose. I know that my purpose is legitimate, because that's a test in legitimate interest. I know that the processing I'm doing is necessary for that purpose. In other words, that it can't be done in any less intrusive way. And even though my purpose may be legitimate and the processing necessary for it, I still have to pass the test of, is my interest in doing, or society's interest in this activity, not overridden by the individual's interest in protecting their interests, their fundamental rights. Or if I go with the yellow screen, the consent one, again I've got the purpose, I know the implications in advance, and the individual can adopt the permission. So those are the controls I've got under the current toolkit. Big data. Most big data that seems to be going on at the moment uses what people variously call data debris, the stuff we leave behind. So actually, the existence of that data, the collection of it, has already been legitimised by something else. So whether it's the data that I create because my digital device has to connect to any road, that involves some passing of data around. It may be necessary for contract, it may be necessary for legal duty, necessary for something. But there is a legitimately existing collection of data there. Then I come up with, I'd like to use that for something else. I think you do have to specify the something else at the level of the purpose. I can't see a mechanism for the hypothesized, completely unconstrained big data research. I don't actually think that's a legal issue, I think that's a social issue. I don't think society is prepared to accept this data was given to your GP to treat you. We are going to use it to improve the treatment of others, okay, we are going to use this to improve insurance policy, not OCAD. Care data did not die because it broke a legal taboo, it died because it broke a social taboo. And I don't think any legislation can actually get around that. So I think you need a verdict. But I haven't got implications. I don't know what the implications are, so I can't do consent. I cannot get valid consent at this point. So my only option is the blue screen, legitimate interest. I do my processing, I come up with some hypotheses. Now I've got an idea. Now I can do the same calculations on the idea. I know the implications. Suppose the idea is correct, suppose the idea is false. I know the implications of what I will now need to do to the individual, in respect to the individual, possibly putting the individual at risk or a benefit, and I can go and get valid consent. This looks weird. I've never seen this in any data protection law structure. Unless you look back to 2011, when you find what seems to me to be the Article 29 working party actually describing it. I can't imagine they knew what they were doing. I must be reusing their data for a purpose they hadn't thought of. I think it's a bit silly. But downstream consent can also be requested downstream when the purpose of the processing changes. Downstream consent, what I'm talking about. In this case, the information to be provided will have to focus on what is needed in the specific context in relation to the purpose. Absolutely, I can now get valid consent because I know what I'm doing. This is the opinion on consent, by the way. So what I'm looking at is I've got two stages, splitting any big data, any data debris, anywhere processing into two stages. There's the analysis stage where I'm finding patterns. There, I'm working on the legitimate interest framework. I must minimize the impact on the subject. I must state a purpose. I must only, or purposes, I must be limited to those purposes. And I have given notice of those purposes at the time of collection. And it was interesting that I talk about markets. Talks about market, because I wonder if there might become a market in secondary purposes. In a way, and again I thought, that's a really novel idea. And then I went to my mobile phone, and I downloaded an app, and it said, pay us money and the adverts will go away. Isn't that a market in secondary purposes? Do you allow us to use your data for advertising, or are you going to buy us out of that? That starts to feel like a secondary market. I actually was doing ad funding, my first mail client, I think it was Eudora, which came in free ad funded. I'm showing my age, nobody's nodding. It was an ad funded version of Eudora, which was free, or you could pay for it. Pattern finding. Now I've got a pattern, now I know consumers, male consumers who wear sports jackets in their mid-50s might be interested in the following products. That's a pattern, doesn't carry any significant, I can minimize the risk to individuals. What I now want to do is say, okay, which of my consumers match that pattern? And at that point I'm in pattern matching intervention mode. And I've changed, the key thing is I've changed from minimizing the impact on the subject to now I'm maximizing the impact on the subject. Whether I'm intervening to improve their health, to improve their prospects in university, or to sell them a product I can sell them. You're looking to maximize the impact. So there's a big change in what you're trying to do with it. And here, you should be looking for informed consent. That seems an appropriate model. So now I've got my notice, couple of notes on this. I think the Article 29 say get consent when the purpose changes. I think there's huge value in getting consent even if the purpose doesn't change, because you're flagging up. I am moving from a impact minimization mode to an impact maximization mode, and we are doing that by mutual agreement. I've been looking at this in the context of learning analytics in universities, where you are going to a student and saying, we can work together to reduce your likelihood of dropping out. Whatever, that's great. If you have a new purpose, if your research, if your big data stuff comes up, so actually, there's some interesting ideas here, some pattern, but they're not related to the original purpose. Purpose limitation says you have to stop. Couple of options at this point. You can either go back to the people whose data you're processing and say, we thought of this possibly hugely beneficial purpose. Can we add, start including your data in the new analysis stage to that purpose? Again, possibly a market layer. Or you can start again, start offering a new product in future, product in the sort of broad sense of including some extra options for that purpose. And again, offer that to your new consumers, whether they want to buy into this new type of analysis or stick with the old one. So why should I trust this? Why is this better, I think, than the previous one? For everybody. Suppose, and I try to be, I am a well-intentioned data controller. I want to use big data because I can see fantastic value. I want to know how to do it right. If I look at the consent to data collection model, I discover how to write privacy notices. I don't discover what things I should ask in my privacy notices and which I should not. It doesn't help me at all on that. If I'm a consumer, I'm a data subject, I know that during the pattern matching stage, there should be a continuing check that the patterns are heading towards the purpose stated, that the processing is necessary for those purposes, that the purposes are legitimate, and that the rights have been balanced. With consent, it's a gateway, we said earlier. This isn't a gateway, this should be an ongoing check. There's this option of additional purposes, perhaps, for forming a market. I guess this is your idea of futures. You know, you're offering people different options. You might get more services, you might have to pay. Have you looked at the option of paying data versus paying money, which partly addresses the market problem, I'm not sure you're about that. And once we get to the point of, now I have a solution for you, I get a fully informed choice. Ideally, I would like that to be, do you want a personalized service or a vanilla service? I think in education, that probably does work. Do you want it to be treated as a special student in this way, to have this additional help, or do you want to be treated as a vanilla member of the class? And something that the GDPR, that there is a very severe frown written into the text of the GDPR about by using this service, you consent to ABCDE. You don't need to do it. The consent takes place completely separate from the use of the service. I've got the regulator. It's great for regulators. Regulators have all these wonderful handles. Right. Regulators have legitimacy, necessity, rights balance, minimization. Yeah, agreed, regulators may not do it. But at least they're in a better position at the moment, because my looking at regulator action at the moment, apologies if there's anybody from the Information Commission here, I see them proofreading Google's privacy notice. I'd like them to do more than that. I want the regulator on.